Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology News webinar. It's entitled Using Human Cardiomyocytes in Phenotypic Screens and Target Verification. With its ability to recapitulate native cellular behavior, human-induced pluripotent stem cell technology has the power and potential to bring human biology into the lab. Cellular Dynamics International is one company that has harnessed this power and potential. The company produces stem cell-derived tissue cells from clinical and non-clinical donors at high quality and at industrial levels so that they can be used in large-scale drug discovery efforts. The goal is to effectively move the bioindustry toward more relevant human-based models. The transition from conception to implementation has happened fairly quickly, moving from launch to regulatory evaluation and use in drug discovery screens in 3 years. Our webinar presentations will highlight examples and the utility of using human iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes in drug discovery and screening efforts. But first, let's meet our panelists. Dr. Ann Bang is Director of Cell Biology at the Conrad Prebys Center for Chemical Genomics within the Sanford Burnham Medical Research Institute. She will discuss her findings from high-content screen analyses for small molecules that reverse induced hypertrophic phenotypes in iCell cardiomyocytes. Dr. Siobhan Mullaney serves as chemical biology leader, also at the Conrad Prebys Center for Chemical Genomics. She'll present her findings from high-throughput chemical biology screens for small molecule inhibitors that prevent or delay oxidative stress-induced death of cardiomyocytes during cell therapy. And Dr. Jason Thomas Maines is Director of Research for Anesthesia and Pain Medicine at the Sick Kids Research Institute within the Hospital for Sick Children. He will describe his approach of using iPS cell-derived iCell cardiomyocytes to model clinical disease, and there's going to be a particular focus on how to identify new therapeutics. After the panelists make their presentations, there will be a question and answer segment. Feel free to send in a question for our panelists at any time during the webinar. Type your question into the Ask a Question box on the left side of your console and then hit Submit. The panel will try to answer as many as possible right after the presentations. I'm John Sterling, Editor-in-Chief of GEN, and I'm going to serve as the moderator. So if everyone's ready, let's get going. Dr. Ann Bang will be our lead, our presenter. And the floor is all yours.
All right. So I'm going to discuss phenotypic screening of cardiac hypertrophy using patient-specific induced pluripotent stem cell-derived cardiomyocytes. So I lead a stem cell and disease modeling lab within the Prebys Center, a state-of-the-art drug discovery facility at the Sanford Burnham Institute in San Diego. We're a bicoastal center with operations located at both the San Diego and Orlando Sanford Burnham campuses, and we're staffed by about 70 FTEs. Our capabilities run the full gamut from assay development to ultra high throughput screening to lead optimization. We're very collaborative. We partner with industry, government, and private organizations with the goal of discovering drugs for unmet medical needs. So with the advent of induced pluripotent stem cell technology and Yamanaka's seminal discovery that a simple cell like a fibroblast from a patient can be converted into a stem cell, which can then be made into many different cell types of the body, there's been a lot of excitement about bringing these cells into the drug discovery process with the hopes that they would aid in understanding underlying mechanism of disease in human cells, patient stratification so drugs can be better matched with individual patients based on their genetics, identification of drug targets and development of diagnostics and prognostics, screening for and testing drugs or lead to drugs, and finally, in the long run, hopefully they'll provide better predictive models of drug efficacy and toxicity than rodent cells or transformed cells. So although there's been an amazing amount of progress, this excitement is tempered by some of the technical hurdles that need to be overcome before the potential can be really exploited. In order for iPS cells to be useful for drug screening, there are a number of requirements that need to be met. Namely, the cells have to be enriched, available in large batches that are of quality. This will enable ideally large-scale primary screens, but also smaller-scale secondary screens and focused experiments looking at drug response. The iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes produced by CDI meet these criteria, in my view. So today I'm going to present preliminary results from a very fruitful collaboration between my group at the Prebys Center in San Diego, Dr. Uli Birkel's lab at Wisconsin Medical College, and Cellular Dynamics International, focused on using iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes to study left ventricular hypertrophy, a step towards one of the ultimate goals of iPS technology, to use the cells to model complex polygenic diseases. So left ventricular hypertrophy is a common risk factor for cardiovascular disease, including myocardial infarction, stroke, and heart failure. Current treatment strategies focus on both prevention and regression of the disease phenotype by targeting risk factors such as hypertension and diabetes. However, for many LVH patients, these treatment options really only provide a limited response. We propose that drug testing, screening, and target identification approaches that rely on clinical cohorts of patients will generate more effective therapies as they can account for population variances in both disease manifestation and response to treatment. So to test this idea, Dr. Brookel, leading a consortium of scientists in collaboration with CDI, has generated a large panel of patient-specific iPS lines from families with an increased risk of left ventricular hypertrophy. So the patient cohorts used to generate these iPS lines are from the Hypergen NHLBI Family Blood Pressure Program. In this program, which includes both African-American and Caucasian cohorts, a large number of patients were phenotyped for cardiovascular phenotypes and risk factors in a family-based ascertainment that included both affected and unaffected relatives. Genome-wide association studies were performed in families to identify potential risk genes. 250 iPS lines were generated, and importantly, these lines are represented by 50% African Americans and 50% Caucasians, as it's well known that these populations exhibit differences in cardiovascular disease. So the main goal of the study is to determine the contribution of risk factor genes to hypertrophy phenotypes using the iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes in hopes of better stratifying these patient populations. The project that I'm going to describe today is to use these iPS lines for drug screening. So the design of our initial study, which is a small focused drug screen, is to identify bioactive compounds and drugs that might modulate hypertrophic phenotypes on control iPS-derived cardiomyocytes using a hypertrophy model that I'll describe. So once we have a hit set of compounds from this screen, we plan to then test them on patient-derived iPS cardiomyocytes to see whether there's a differential response, which we predict will contribute to a better understanding of how these patients could be stratified, especially when combined with information from GWAS studies. Our initial screen is focused on known drugs and bioactives, so there could be possibilities or opportunities for drug repurposing, but importantly, we may identify compounds that would aid in probing the biology underlying this polygenic disease and leading to better target identification. So this next slide describes the hypertrophy model that was used. Briefly, iPSC-derived control cardiomyocytes are plated on 384-well microtiter imaging plates and then treated with a secreted protein, endothelin-1, a well-known inducer of hypertrophy. Using Perkin-Elmer's high-content system, images were acquired on the OPERA and analyzed with a cappella software. We observed, as expected, that endothelin-1 induces cellular changes characteristic of cardiac hypertrophy in a dose-dependent manner, including increases in expression of brain natriuretic peptide, or BNP, a biomarker for hypertrophy, and as well corresponding increases in cell size. So this assay will be the basis of the screen on control cardiomyocytes that I'm going to discuss. But just for a moment, I wanted to discuss another issue. What if we look at the left ventricular patient-derived iPS cardiomyocytes? So we've just begun these studies. As the first cardiomyocytes are being produced from the LVH patient iPS lines, and preliminary analyses indicate that some of these lines exhibit signs of hypertrophy. This slide illustrates how in the absence of addition of endothelin-1, this LVH patient, iPS cardiomyocytes, exhibit elevated basal levels of BNP expression compared with the control line, suggesting that the patient lines will be useful for modeling this disease. These preliminary studies are promising and are ongoing and will eventually include entire cohorts of patient lines. But in the meantime, we're using control cardiomyocytes to screen for drugs that modulate endothelin-induced hypertrophy, and I'll describe the preliminary data from this screen in the next slide. So first, before we get into the pilot screen, I'd like to take a moment to describe our image analysis process using Perkin-Elmer's OPERA high-content system and its associated a cappella software. So in a first step, nuclei are identified based on size and brightness thresholds we set. This is followed by determination of the cytoplasm and then determination of the paranuclear region where the highest levels of the secreted protein BNP are localized as the protein transits through the ER. From these types of analyses, we can determine the level of BNP fluorescent intensity, the cell size, and as well features of the actin-sized skeleton, which I'll touch on at the end of the presentation. So in addition, we also measure multiple nuclear parameters which reflect cell health, such as simply the number of nuclei, the DAPI staining intensity, the size of the nuclei, and their shape. So as the next step in assay development, we showed that the drugs macitentan and bosentan, antagonists of the endothelin 1 receptor, not surprisingly, could be used as controlled compounds. So as expected, endothelin 1 induction of BNP is inhibited by the endothelin receptor antagonists bosentan and macitentan in dose-dependent manner. So the Z-factor that we obtained was around 0.5, either plus or minus endothelin 1 or plus or minus macitentan in the presence of endothelin 1, indicating that the assay is sufficiently robust for screening. So this next slide illustrates the workflow of the screen. On day zero, the cardiomyocytes are thawed, and they're plated on fibronectin-coated 384 well plates at a density of around 500 cells per well. The cells are allowed to recover in culture for 2 days, and on the second day, the media is replaced with Williams E media plus supplements, so it's serum-free. The cells are cultured for 2 more days in this media. The Williams E is replaced again, and the endothelin 1 is added in addition to compounds. On the fifth day, the cells are fixed with paraformaldehyde and then stained with the anti-BNP antibody. So the screen was performed in duplicate on 10 384 well plates. The compound libraries that were screened were the Prestwick library, which consists of 1,200 compounds, primarily approved drugs, and the EMD kinase inhibitor library of about 327 compounds. So we've completed a pilot primary screen, and the preliminary data are shown in this scatter plot of BNP expression level compared with the control macitentan. The primary screen was performed at 5 micromolar on 384 well plates with an 18-hour treatment of endothelin 1 plus compound. Macitentan was used as a control at 5 micromolar, and again, our average Z-prime was around 0.5. As expected, we pulled out the endothelin 1 receptor antagonists, ambrisentan and bosentan, and our hit rate for the Prestwick library was 5.1% hits in duplicate that scored at least 50% activity compared with the macitentan control. For the kinase inhibitor library, our hit rate was 6.7% hits in duplicate. So the hit rates are on the high side, and it's perhaps not surprising since the libraries are focused and many of the hits fell into clusters of similar drugs, and as well we screened at 5 micromolar. So the next slide shows some examples of hits from the screen. Here you can see a PI3 kinase inhibitor that clearly downregulated induction of BNP by endothelin, and as well an MK2 inhibitor that appeared to cause upregulation of a BNP expression. So we've completed the primary screen, and now we're focused on finishing off the data analysis and performing confirmation and dose response screen, at which point we'll classify the hits based on clustering of structurally similar compounds and compounds that have similar targets and/or pathways and the features affected. So looking forward, we'll test the confirmed hit set on other modes of hypertrophy induction, including angiotensin II and isoproterenol, and on left ventricular hypertrophy patient iPSC-derived cardiomyocytes. So this last slide illustrates how we are multiplexing as many features as possible, leveraging the power of high-content imaging. Shown here are actin fluorescein stains, which exhibit clear differential patterns in response to drug treatment, which along with the analysis of alpha-actinin expression will allow us to assess the actin-sized skeleton. We've not completed the analysis yet of our primary pilot screen, but it will take into account readouts of multiple features affected, including not only BNP expression, but cell size, actin-cytoskeleton, and as well, we're looking at microRNAs isolated from exosomes in the media. So in summary, based on our preliminary studies with these cells, we're convinced that iPS-derived cardiomyocytes have great promise for drug screening. And I'll end here and thank the people who did the work. In my lab at the Sanford Burnham Prebys Center in San Diego, Haowen Zhao, Manny Ruiz Diaz, Fu Yu Zhang, and then the leader of the center, Michael Jackson, who's very supportive of these programs. Uli Bruckel at the Medical College of Wisconsin, and Andrea Matter in his lab. And then Blake Anson, Melanie Pierce, and Kobe Carlson at Cellular Dynamics International.
Anne, thank you very much for that very detailed discussion on the use of iCell cardiomyocytes to model hypertrophy and how to develop effective screens to find small molecules that can reverse induced hypertrophic phenotypes in iCell cardiomyocytes. That was a very clear and focused presentation, so much, much appreciated, and I know I represent the audience when I say that. If anyone is just now joining our webinar, welcome. As I mentioned earlier, we will be presenting a Q&A segment following the panelists' presentations. Please type your question for any or all of our panelists into the Ask a Question box on the lower left of your console and then hit Submit. Our second panelist, Siobhan Mullaney, is ready to begin her presentation. Siobhan?
Thank you, John. I'd like to share today a project where we've utilized human-induced pluripotent stem cell-derived cardiomyocytes in high-throughput screening. This is a project we performed at the Conrad Prebys Center at Sanford Burnham in Orlando, Florida. And this screen is a phenotypic screen to identify cardioprotective molecules. So this project has specific application in heart disease, and heart disease, as we know, is a leading cause of mortality in the United States. And stem cell therapy, or the delivery of stem cells to the damaged heart, holds great promise for a broad spectrum of cardiac disorders. However, this therapy approach has had modest and inconsistent clinical improvements in cardiac function, and the reason for that is that most of the transplanted cells die about 90% in the first 24 hours before they even have a chance to attach to the heart tissue. And ischemic and oxidative stress are relevant stress stimuli in the transplant environment that causes these cells to die. So in our screening campaign for the engraftment of stem cells to be successful, we've come up with a screening platform to identify compounds that will either prevent or delay the death of these cells so that they have a chance to attach to the heart. And our oxidative stress assay that I'll talk about recapitulates the post-myocardial infarction oxidative stress, and this uses peroxide as the main stress inducer. So we're hoping in this screening cascade to identify probe compounds and potential drugs that will reveal or better understand mechanisms of stem cell survival during oxidative stress to potentially lead to improved cardiac cell therapy approaches. Our primary assay is an acute oxidative stress assay for high-throughput screening, and it's relatively straightforward. However, using peroxide and stem cells does prove to be challenging, and so we've implemented a 1536-well platform that into a screening mode that has proven to be very reproducible. And the peroxide working concentration is quite stable over time, as shown in the white bars in the bar graph. We can actually go out to about 4 hours, and peroxide levels are stable, so that makes it very conducive for high-throughput screening. The cells themselves will start to utilize catalase enzyme activity to break down the peroxide over time, and you see that in the black bars. After about 45 minutes, the peroxide levels will decrease. If there's any pyruvate in the media, pyruvate is a scavenger of peroxide, and so in the red bars you see, if that's the case, the peroxide levels decrease quite rapidly. So we've had to balance all of these issues because the stem cell cardiomyocytes do rely on a pyruvate-containing media. So the peroxide concentration, the assay time, the media composition, and pH were all very critical to making the primary assay conducive for screening. On the right panel is a titration of peroxide over a concentration range, and the readout here is an ATP viability readout, luminescence-based, and we're using 300 micromoles peroxide in our assays, which, as you can see here, reduces the viability to below 10%, so kills more than 90% of the cells, and so we're looking for compounds that will actually prevent that those cells from dying in this assay. So before we launched our larger campaign, we ran about 50,000 compounds, but we first ran the library of pharmaceutically active compounds and the FDA collection, international and U.S. library, to establish a proof of concept for our screen. And here we showed there were a number of dopamine-related agonists that we picked up in the low-pack library of 1,280 compounds. The FDA collection is the same size, and we found fewer hits there, but one in particular that showed promise, cycloprox, which is an antifungal agent. And what's nice about using these libraries, it's an annotated set, so you understand some of the characteristics. And these compounds that we did pick up in the stem cell cardiomyocyte oxidative stress assay do exhibit cardioprotectant activities published in the literature. We followed up with dose response curves. This is a 1536-well suspension assay. We get the same results if we do 384-well adherent. And so we showed dose response activity for the dopamine agonist and the antifungal cycloprox compound we found in the FDA collection. And most of those showed at least a 50 to 100% protection from the oxidative stress. One of the main reasons that we chose to work with stem cells for this screen, as they are much more expensive than regular recombinant cells, is that we had previously run a similar screen using peroxide in rat cardiomyocytes, H9C2 cells. We went forward with two different chemical scaffolds from that screen and did extensive medicinal chemistry follow-up to identify two probe compounds representing the two scaffolds. And as you saw in this graph in the pink squares and purple circles, that those two compounds were not active in protecting the stem cell cardiomyocytes. So we're seeing a difference in cell type, and we chose to move forward in a physiologically relevant cell-based screen using the stem cell cardiomyocytes. And those two probe compounds also did not show great promise in rat perfused heart studies. So we'll be able to look at some of the compounds that we identify from the stem cell screen and compare with the cell type as well. So the main difference between the stem cell cardiomyocytes and rat H9C2 cells is that they do differ in energy utilization. So it's probably not a species difference, but more the how these cells utilize energy. In this graph, which is from a seahorse experiment, the stem cell cardiomyocytes show increased mitochondrial respiration. It's shown by oxygen consumption rates, more so than the rat H9C2 cells, which rely more on a glycolysis pathway. So this is important as we're looking at protection from ROS-induced damage to the mitochondria. The compounds that I showed in our dose response from the low-pack and FDA libraries should have evidence that they protect from mitochondrial dysfunction in an oxidative stress environment. So, for example, the dopamine D1 agonists are all related analogs of chloro-APB hydrobromide analogs. These are indirect inhibitors of peroxide-induced PERP-P activation in myocytes, and PERP-P function as a DNA damage sensor in the nucleus, and its overactivation leads to cell dysfunction and death. So that's a relevant mechanism for these types of compounds. In addition, the D2 compound is an apomorphine analog. It has antioxidant activities in isolated rat-perfused heart studies, specifically attenuates myocardial protein oxidation. And then the cycloprox antifungal agent that we picked up in the FDA collection is an indirect inhibitor of mitochondrial permeability transition pore opening in isolated rat liver. So all of these examples are really pointing toward very relevant mechanisms that are protecting ROS-induced damage in the mitochondrial and nucleus. Now moving on to our larger screen, we did run a 1536-well screen using the stem cell cardiomyocytes in about 50,000 compounds. And the protocol that we used was we first grew the cells for at least 7 days in culture, and then first dispensed compounds using an echoacoustic dispenser, which delivers nanoliter quantities to the plates. We then used suspension cells for a two-hour period. So this is our protection time with the compounds protecting the stem cells. Then we added the 300 micromole peroxide for 30 minutes at 37 degrees, and then an additional 10 minutes at room temperature before reading an ATP viability luminescence readout. So fairly straightforward screen, and the main expense of the screen is really in the stem cells. What was really very nice about the screen, we ran about 40 15 36 well plates, and we saw very clean patterning across these plates. Here I just show two representative plates, and in the red wells is our positive control, or our high viability, which is just the cells with 0.5% DMSO. The 0.5% DMSO is not toxic to the cells. We have 10 micromole single point concentration of test compound across the plate, and the last four rows or columns have 300 micromole peroxide as our negative control, which essentially kills almost all of the cells. And so the test compounds are in the presence of the 300 micromole peroxide. We had a very nice histogram for this 50,000 compound screen. As shown in this slide, the blue are the test compounds that have a histogram that straddles the negative control in yellow, which is just the cells exposed to DMSO and 300 micromole peroxide. So that's the low viability readout. And then in red, we have the high viability or positive control, which are cells exposed to the 0.5% DMSO. And our red line there is our cutoff. We went to a 35% cutoff response for our hits. And we were able to go that low really because we had some very nice statistics in the screen. Our signal to background is ninefold, and our Z prime is 0.63, which is great. The RZ prime is a robust Z prime that we get from pattern correction using gene data. And as we see here, that's exactly statistically the same. So we really didn't have any pattern correction across the screen. This slide shows a different view of how the screen performed. It's showing each individual plate that we tested. And again, the red dots is the positive control, and yellow is negative control. The peroxide and the blue spots are the test compounds. So you can see by plate the number of hits on particular plates versus others. Just, again, shows how well the screen performed. We've now moved on to confirming these hits. So from our almost 50,000 compound collection, screened at 10 micromole, we chose the 35% cutoff and received 220 hits from that, about a 0.45% hit rate. We cherry-picked those compounds, ran them again in duplicate at the 10 micromole concentration, again, took a 35% cutoff, and around half of those confirmed, and the confirmation plate is shown here again with the red wells as the positive control, and you can see in duplicate how some of these compounds either confirmed or did not confirm, and we're currently testing the compounds in a reactive oxygen species counter screen assay to show that they're not scavengers. And most of the scaffolds don't appear to look like they're scavengers, an important step in this assay. And then we are taking those scaffolds and reordering the powders and very close analogs to run concentration response assay. And then we'll move actually away from the ATP viability readout into a label-free assay, which I'll talk about in the next slide. The label-free impedance assay is actually a very powerful tool that we can look at, move away from just the acute time frame of our primary assay. This is a real-time experiment that we do over 24 hours. It also shows response as well as potential toxicity of compounds. So we use the C-Excelligence instrument, which is an impedance-based system for monitoring stem cell contractility. So it shows cell morphology as well as the electrophysiological features of the cells. And we can monitor the peroxide effect specifically on the stem cell beating rate and rhythm. So these stem cells are plated in 96-well fibronectin-coated plates for 14 days. This establishes a very nice beating pattern over those times, and then we measure the contractility, which is an impedance value at a resolution such that the system can pick up the shape change in these cells as the cells contract and relax. This slide shows a typical cardiogram that we can get from this instrument. So first, as I mentioned, we establish a consistent beating pattern, which shows here in the pretreatment box, and that's typical beating rate of stem cell cardiomyocytes. And then we can add the compound. This is an apomorphine analog that we picked up from the LOPAC screen. It's a D2 agonist and also has beta adrenergic activity. So as you can see in the two-hour compound box there, the beating rate does pick up a little bit, and that's pretty typical of this type of dopamine agonist. So then we can add peroxide to the cells. We added 75 micromole and monitor at a number of time points. So here I'm showing 30 minutes, 2 hours, up to 24 hours. And the brown traces at the bottom is just the control wells that have no apomorphine analog compound added to them, and you can see that that beating pattern is really wiped out once you add the peroxide, and it stays flat over the course of the time period. Then as in those wells that have compound, as the more compound that's in there, you see this protection occurring for the contractility. And so the 10 micromole, for example, goes back to pretreatment and shows really protection of that beating rate. And the top red is also control that has no peroxide added. So this is a really, as I mentioned, a powerful tool for looking at real-time contractility and the effects. Now going from our 30-minute primary assay, we can look at longer time points. As some of the results from these types of experiments are shown here, the apomorphine analog is in black and the cyclopox compound is in red. And this is looking at an amplitude readout that is normalized to plus and minus the peroxide. So we're looking at 0 to 100% of basic protection from the amplitude, which is where we saw most of the effects occurring for these compounds. And in the solid bars are in for 30 minutes, and the dotted line is 24 hours. So here we can see that at about a micromole for these two compounds at 30 minutes, we're really seeing full protection of the amplitude for these stem cell cardiomyocytes. Again, at 24 hours, for example, with the cycloprox, we do see after at about 10 micromole that the cells are no longer protected. This could be a toxicity of this compound. That's what's nice about using this instrument, is that you can both look at response and you can look at cytotoxicity of the compound. And so we'll really be able to, once we have some candidate compounds from our screen, we'll be able to put them in this experiment and look more at their mechanism in terms of the beating rate and rhythm of the cardiomyocytes. In summary, and our future plans involve, showcased in this slide, is that we've done the chemical biology approach in the 50,000 compound screen, and we've identified some initial scaffolds and starting points for medicinal chemistry follow-up that are, these compounds are at least showing cardioprotection in our stem cell cardiomyocyte screen. And so we'll further improve on those and test them in our ASEA Exelligence contractility assay. And then one of the very attractive and promising approaches in this field for treating heart disease is to take cells from patients and reprogram them and then transplant them into the same patient. And so here we're looking forward to utilizing patient-specific stem cells and moving those forward in more of a translational project in the future. In acknowledgments, Ada Ku, previously in my group, who has gone on to a PhD program in Hong Kong, did all of the initial assay development for this project. Jason Kirby has followed up with conducting the entire screen, the ASC Exelligence experiments, and he will do all the follow-up chemistry biology experiments. My collaborator, Richard Kitsis at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, has been very great in providing advice, and we also had collaborated on the first H92C screen. And I really want to thank Cellular Dynamics International for jumpstarting this project and providing stem cells that we could gather some initial data Blake Anson and Colby Carlson, who we provided consistent support and advice in moving this forward. We were able to get enough data together, and I applied to the Florida Translational Research Program, which has financed the screen and the downstream chemistry efforts. And Leighton Smith is the PI and administrator of this program. And thank you very much. And back to you, John.
Thank you, Siobhan, for showing how high-throughput screens can be used to find small molecular inhibitors that prevent or delay oxidative stress-induced death of cardiomyocytes during cell therapy. And, as you point out, more exciting work needs to be done in this area as well. Thank you. Once again, we invite you to send in questions for our panelists for our upcoming Q&A session. Just type your question into the Ask a Question box and then hit Submit. Our third panelist, Dr. Jason Thomas Maines, is ready to begin his presentation. Jason, you can go.
All right. Thank you very much. I'm going to focus a little bit different in my talk. I'm going to look at how we can use iPS cardiomyocytes to better model human disease and therefore provide more intelligent therapies to patients going forward. Because as you've heard, there's many different ways to look at therapies at the cellular level, but cardiomyocytes don't exist as isolated cells in the body. They exist as part of a collaborative organ, and so the therapies that you develop need to work at both the cellular level but also within the context of the organ. And so we have to better model those diseases in order to make the therapies that we develop actually work in patient care. And so that's something that my lab does is, in particular, is designing new models of cardiac disease and then looking for either protein or small molecule type therapies for those diseases. This is important when you look at the scope of cardiac disease, which is, quite broad and not just at the cardiomyocyte level. The most common one in adults would be coronary artery disease or ischemic heart disease. On the pediatric side, cardiomyopathy is much more common for us, especially dilated cardiomyopathy, which can be caused by genetic mutations, or especially drug-induced is something we see a lot. About 70% of pediatric cancer patients who receive oncology drugs will end up with dilated cardiomyopathy, and about 10% of those will end up with a heart transplantation. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy can happen from hypertension in adults and somewhat in children. Certainly genetic causes are very common in pediatrics and adults, and then restrictive cardiomyopathy. There's also a separate set of diseases that end up in heart failure, including arrhythmogenic diseases that are primarily genetic, certain congenital malformations. Within pediatrics and adults, we have infective cardiac diseases where certain bacteria will take up residence and affect cardiac function, and then valvular diseases that are a huge issue in the adult population. So if we want to model these cardiac diseases, we have to be able to show that at the cellular level, we're able to recapitulate the disease that's happening within the organ. Otherwise, the therapies we develop using high-throughput screening, et cetera, really are just for academics as opposed to actually providing a therapy for the patients. So one common pathway for all of these cardiac diseases is heart failure. And heart failure is, as I said, it can be caused by many different intrinsic diseases of the heart, but uniformly has about a 10% annual mortality and only a 50% five-year survival or five-year mortality equal both ways. So once you're in heart failure, you really have a very profound reduction in your life expectancy. And we have some problems right now modeling heart failure, partially because it comes from a very diverse set of etiologies or causes, but also because the models that we use right now are not particularly good. So the most common models for this type of therapy are mouse and pig. And mouse obviously is a cheaper or easier model to use than a pig, but the mouse heart doesn't contract the way a human heart does. It relies on rate rather than contractility. And what we see in heart failure is really a reduction in contractility, not rate. So the mouse has intrinsic problems. Now, the pig heart is actually much closer to a human heart, but has issues because of the expense of using pigs. And again, it's still not the human proteome. It's not the same set of proteins that a human has. We can do deconstructed or models like iPS cardiomyocytes that can have issues because they don't really model organ function per se, and so that's something you need to take into consideration. And then the human heart isn't just made up of a single type of cardiomyocyte. It has distinct cell types with distinct functions. It has atrial cells, ventricular cells, nodal cells, conducting cells, and so all of those things need to be taken into consideration when you're looking at the ability to model a human disease by an iPS cardiomyocyte or any other model for that matter. But if you want to look at heart failure as a final common pathway, that's a way to look at therapies that may be applicable across a broad range of cardiac diseases. And so that's what my lab primarily looks at. And one protein that we're interested in is integrin-linked kinase, which is the central molecule shown here that interacts with many different proteins within the cardiomyocyte. So despite its name, integrin-linked kinase is actually not a kinase. It's a scaffolding protein that interacts with integrins at the cell surface and cell attachment, but then has interactions with intracellular proteins, including actin and the cytoskeleton. And integrin-linked kinase functions as a force transducer in the heart. So it improves cardiac contractility and is shown to be downregulated in heart failure. And so what we wanted to do at first was show whether integrin-linked kinase was dysregulated in certain particularly pediatric cardiac diseases, using it as sort of a scaffolding or a nodal protein of cardiac survival signaling. And so I'll show you here some of the mechanisms by which we show that integrin-linked kinase was dysregulated in human disease. So on the left-hand side, we have normal heart tissue. They're taken from pediatric patients undergoing heart surgery for a ventricular septal defect, or VSD. So the contractility of that heart is fine. Those patients are not in heart failure. It's a small hole in the heart that has to be repaired surgically, but the function is actually fine. Where on the right-hand side, we have patients undergoing heart transplantation, pediatric patients undergoing heart transplantation for heart failure from dilated cardiomyopathy, or DCM. So the primary regulatory molecule in the heart cell for calcium is CIRCA2A. This protein is involved in taking calcium from the cytoplasm and putting it back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum. That recycling of the calcium back into the SR is what generates force contraction in the cell, in the cardiomyocyte in particular. And so pathognomonic for heart failure is a decreased activity of CIRCA2A and an increased cytosolic with a decreased sarcoplasmic calcium level. And so what we showed here is that in normal hearts, normal functioning hearts, VSD hearts, integrin-linked kinase, or ILK, overlaps with CIRCA2A very well. So you can see in the big picture of the VSD and then a close-up in the middle image, which shows that they overlap almost perfectly. Now, in the DCM or failing heart picture, you can see that they don't overlap well at all. So there's loss of the association between integrin-linked kinase and CIRCA2A. Part of the cardiac contractility machinery is troponin C, and that's shown as TNC in the bottom set of panels. And again, integrin-linked kinase and troponin C organize well in parallel this time in the cardiomyocyte, and that association is lost in dilated cardiomyopathy. So we show that integrin-linked kinase associates with CIRCA2A and troponin C in the cardiomyocyte, and that's lost in heart failure as evidence that integrin-linked kinase could be important, or the loss of function could be important in heart failure. And what we went on to show is that integrin-linked kinase levels were actually lower in these failed hearts. So on the left-hand side, you can see right ventricular muscle bundle from these VSD hearts, or RVMB. So those are normal functioning hearts, and DCM, or dilated cardiomyopathy, and three patients for each. So you can see, in general, the integrin-linked kinase protein levels are lower in the heart failure patients, with a lower level of CIRCA2A. So not only does integrin-linked kinase drop, but also the calcium recycling protein, CIRCA2A, drops. As a potential regulatory mechanism for this, we detected that phosphorylated GSK3 beta, which is associated with cardiac contractility, is also decreased in these failing hearts. Importantly, inhibition of CIRCA2A is increased. So the natural inhibitor of CIRCA2A is phospholamban, or PLN. When PLN is phosphorylated, in our diagram or our blot here shown as PPLN, then inhibition of CIRCA2A is lost. So a decrease in PPLN increases the inhibition of circuit 2A. So not in these failing hearts, not only do we have less circuit 2A protein around to pump calcium back into the SR, but we also have less or more of the inhibitor of circuit 2A around. So what circuit 2A is there is inhibited to a greater degree. Putting these two things together, you can see why cytosolic calcium is increased during heart failure. So that gave us some evidence, again, that integrin-linked kinase is important in mediating or involved in the pathologic process of dilated cardiomyopathy in particular, but also heart failure. So our next experiment was to go on and look at if we could recapitulate this cardiac phenotype or therapy of this cardiac phenotype in iPS cardiomyocytes, because we needed to have a cellular model that accurately represents the clinical picture. And so we have here an example what happened when we overexpressed integrin-linked kinase in iPS cardiomyocytes. So we have control as C, empty vector as EV, a normal integrin-linked kinase, and then we have an integrin-linked kinase that we have identified a point mutation in that makes it constitutively active by blocking interactions with a inhibitory subunit called alpha-parvin. So you can see we get good overexpression of the integrin-linked kinase in these cells. By increasing the activity of integrin-linked kinase or expression of integrin-linked kinase, we've also increased the circuit 2A level. We've increased the phosphorylated phospholamban level. So we have more circuit 2A around, and we have less of the inhibitory version of phospholamban around. So more circuit 2A and less circuit 2A inhibition, again, improving cardiac calcium cycling. As a potential mechanism to phosphorylate phospholamban, we showed that activity of phosphorylated CAM kinase 2 was also increased. And in fact, that's probably the way in which integrin-linked kinase increases phosphorylation of phospholamban and relieves the inhibition on circuit 2A. So in the iPS cardiomyocytes, we're able to show that integrin-linked kinase can improve the phenotype, or at least the cellular phenotype, of heart failure by increasing circuit 2A activity and improving calcium recycling in the cardiomyocyte. And so we went on in using calcium imaging to show that this was indeed true within these cells. So on the upper left, we have the time constants for calcium cycling. So a lower time constant means that the calcium is recycled into the SR faster. So using the vector control compared to both integrin-linked kinase variants, we could reduce the time constant, meaning calcium was recycled faster. And on the right-hand side, we showed that if we added a circuit 2A inhibitor, thapsigargin or TG, we could remove that improvement that was seen with integrin-linked kinase, illustrating that the beneficial effect of integrin-linked kinase is through circuit 2A. In the bottom panel is where we added a cardiotoxic drug, doxorubicin. So again, on the left two, we see vector control, and then the addition of integrin-linked kinase reduces the time constant, improving calcium cycling. Now, doxorubicin is one of the very common anthracyclines that's given, especially in pediatric cancers, and has a dilated cardiomyopathy that it causes. So addition of doxorubicin to control cells profoundly increased the time constant. And so that means that calcium is not being recycled nearly fast enough and cardiac contractility is compromised. By adding or overexpressing integrin-linked kinase in those cells, we were able to improve the time constant back to normal, showing that we improved and corrected for the doxorubicin-induced changes in calcium cycling within the cell. So next, we wanted to look at and ensure that it was actually sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium that was improved. And so one way to do that is to look at the SR calcium by release of caffeine. So if we have an empty vector cell on the left and we add caffeine, there's no real change to the amount of calcium that's in the sarcoplasmic reticulum compared to the other beats where calcium was not caffeine was not added. On the right-hand side, now you see a much bigger area under the curve after caffeine addition in the ILK cells. This shows that ILK was able to significantly increase the amount of calcium that's present in the sarcoplasmic reticulum that then is released by the caffeine. So we've shown that that ILK can correct the deficiencies in CIRCA2A and improve sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium levels, which would lead to improved cardiac contractility. So this is just a bar graph representing what you saw in the previous slide, showing how much calcium we improve in the sarcoplasmic reticulum to a large degree with regular integrin-linked kinase, but even to a more massive degree with the constitutively active integrin-linked kinase variant. So the next question is, can we actually improve the cardiac contractility phenotype? And so doxorubicin, again, is a common thing that we use to model cardiomyopathy and effects on the cells. And so to test for this, we use the Accelligence machine, which measures impedance changes in iPS cardiomyocytes, and we treated them with doxorubicin. So at the top, you can see we have empty vector integrin-linked kinase and the constitutively active integrin-linked kinase traces, pre-doxorubicin, all equal. B shows the induction of arrhythmias, or gaps, shown by the asterisks, that are induced in the empty vector cells after the addition of doxorubicin, and that those arrhythmias are attenuated or actually eliminated by overexpression of integrin-linked kinase and the constitutively active version as well. In C, you can see the change in the amplitude of beating, so the height of those peaks, where doxorubicin reduces the height, reduces the contractility, reduces the squeeze of the cells, and that's corrected for by both wild-type integrin-linked kinase and the constitutively active variant. So we've corrected both the cellular phenotype of calcium that's induced by doxorubicin and other dilated cardiomyopathies, but we've also corrected the arrhythmias and the contractility that happens as a result of that. So two different metrics to measure the effect of the cells. So another thing that doxorubicin does is on iPS cardiomyocytes is that it slows the beating rate as a result of reducing this calcium cycling. And so on the left-hand side here, you can see a reduction in the beat rate that's seen with the addition of doxorubicin, and integrin-linked kinase fixes that. The amplitude differences or contractility differences in the cells that we see was somewhat or marginally reduced with integrin-linked kinase itself, but was more significantly reduced with the constitutively active variant, again showing that we can attenuate and in some degree completely reverse the adverse changes that are seen with doxorubicin in the iPS cardiomyocytes. So another very common toxicity that happens in cardiac cells, especially with doxorubicin, but really almost anything, and it was referred to by some of the other speakers, is the oxidative damage and the mitochondrial damage that happens. And so we wanted to see if integrin-linked kinase could also protect against doxorubicin-induced mitochondrial damage. So on the upper left, you see normal mitochondria before exposure to doxorubicin. And so the blue are the nuclei and the green are the mitochondria, and what you see is a nice mitochondrial distribution with filamentous mitochondria spread throughout the cell, and that's green. On the upper right now, you see what happens when we add doxorubicin to the cells, and you get collapse of the mitochondria around the nuclei, which are shown by the arrows, and loss of mitochondrial mass in other areas of the cell, shown by asterisks. So you get this balling up of the mitochondria, essentially. Expression of both wild-type integrin-linked kinase in the bottom left and the constitutively active version in the bottom right attenuated these changes significantly. So now we've shown that integrin-linked kinase can improve calcium cycling, CIRCA2A activity, arrhythmias, contractility, and also now preserve mitochondrial function. All of these are important, obviously, within the organ as well, and something we see in clinically important cardiac disease. So the next step was to say, all right, we know that this works on the iPSC level. Can we translate it now back to the organ? And so we made a transgenic mouse model of integrin-linked kinase overexpression. In this particular case, I'm showing you the constitutively active variant. And you see that by overexpression of the R211A or active ILK, we get higher ILK levels in those mice. We get higher CIRCA2A levels. We get induced phosphorylated CAM kinase 2 and phosphorylated phospholamban, meaning less inhibition of CIRCA2A. So the exact same thing we saw in the iPS cardiomyocytes we see in the ILK transgenic mouse model, showing that the iPSs would accurately give us a model of what we see in the whole organ. And these mice, when we give them doxorubicin then, had an improved cardiac contractility, or actually what I should say is less of a decrease in cardiac contractility. So we have an echocardiogram on the left, but more importantly, the metrics on the right, the MPI, which is the contract with a measure of damage, so less damage in the transgenic ILK, or SF is shortening fraction, so a higher number is better in this, in the ILK mice after exposure to doxorubicin. So it attenuated damage at the IPS level, but also attenuated the damage we see in the mice. So our next step was to look at how we could possibly make an ILK-based therapeutic. And to do this, we turned to the crystal structure of integrin-linked kinase, which is shown in purple here as a ribbon model on the left and a solid surface on the right, bound to its inhibitor protein called alpha-parvin. Now, I mentioned that the constitutively active version of ILK didn't bind one of its inhibitory partners, and that indeed is this version here, alpha-parvin. So the interaction between alpha-parvin in red and integrin-linked kinase in purple is really mediated through a single loop of the alpha-parvin, which I've highlighted with an arrowhead there. So we devised a cyclic peptide that binds into that region and disrupts the interaction between ILK and its inhibitory protein, and tested that cyclic peptide for its ability to attenuate doxorubicin-induced cardiac damage. So one of the things that we do is to measure arrhythmia, we use what's called a chaos score or Poincaré analysis. And in a Poincaré analysis or chaos score, if there's arrhythmia, then the points get farther apart or show more chaotic behavior. So as an example of that are the red spots in the upper right-hand corner of this graph. So those are iPS cardiomyocytes exposed to doxorubicin and analyzed in the Accelligence RTCA instrument. And using the R-to-R intervals, we show that there's a variance in what you see from beat to beat, indicating arrhythmia. And so the circle that can encompass those points is quite large in diameter. In comparison, if you look, I've shown it in triplicate, the green, which is control on the bottom left, those points are very tightly clustered, meaning that the rhythm was very regular. Now, if we add doxorubicin to cells that are overexpressing integrin-linked kinase, which is shown in duplicate in blue, again, we get the tight distribution. So integrin-linked kinase the compound that activates integrin-linked kinase that we designed, the cyclic peptide, was able to correct for doxorubicin-induced arrhythmias. And so it doesn't matter where on this graph you lie per se. What matters is your distribution and how tight it is. And so you can see the definite change from the red to the blue and the correction of the arrhythmia that's induced by doxorubicin by the addition of the ILK-activating peptide that we made. So I can't show you any more about that because we're applying for a patent for it right now, but it gives a unifying mechanism then to how integrin-linked kinase can be used as a cardiac therapeutic. So you have mechanical tension within the cell that's attenuated by dilated cardiomyopathy, and again, that dilated cardiomyopathy can be from many different causes, and it can actually be from other types of cardiac disease, including arrhythmogenic diseases as well as ischemic cardiomyopathy. And so integrin-linked kinase interacts with CIRCA2A to improve calcium recycling and increase sarcoplasmic reticulum calcium. And that is usually something that's affected profoundly by many drugs, including anthracyclines and doxorubicin, which are given to a lot of cancer patients. We've shown that integrin-linked kinase activates phosphorylated CAM kinase 2, which in turn phosphorylates phospholamban and relieves the inhibition on CIRCA2A. So you get increased CIRCA2A levels and increased CIRCA2A activity. We've also shown that the known cardioprotective pathway of GSK3 beta is activated by integrin-linked kinase. And a combination of all of these things improves both cardiac contractility, but also something that's well recognized in especially adult cardiology is important now is cardiac relaxation or lusitropy. And so that's so-called diastolic dysfunction is becoming more and more and more important in adult heart failure. So integrin kinase can improve both contractility and cardiac relaxation. So as we said, integrin kinase is a mechanotransducer, and despite its name, it's not actually a kinase. It works by scaffolding proteins into cardioprotective modules and regulates intercellular calcium through circuit 2A, improving cardiac contractility. It promotes mitochondrial function and is an antiarrhythmic. So we have really one of the first therapeutics, well, really the first therapeutic for heart failure that improves cardiac function or contractility. It increases cardiomyocyte survival and improves rhythms. So this would be the first therapy that does all of those things together. So in general, I think the things to remember when you're trying to model human disease with iPS cardiomyocytes, because you can do drug screens and you can do all kinds of things for them, but if they're not actually recapitulating the human disease, it's not worth it. And so something to remember with iPS cardiomyocytes is they are a neonatal cardiomyocyte. So neonatal cardiomyocytes utilize a glycolytic metabolism, which is not what an adult cardiomyocyte does. It uses a lipid metabolism. So you can use special mixtures to induce lipid metabolism in these cells, and people have shown that this induces a more adult-like cardiac phenotype, including the onset of adult-sized diseases. They do have immature T-tubules and have a slightly different calcium handling pathway. And I think those are the things we know about. The one thing you have to keep in mind is, are there any other disease-specific pathways that exist in the neonatal cardiomyocyte that you're not aware of, and therefore you may not be modeling properly? One huge advantage of these iPS cells is that they are a human proteome. So over mice, we have all human proteins, and I mentioned the difference in mice and human cardiac function in that the mice is primarily a rate-related phenomenon, where humans are rate and squeeze or inotropy or contractility, however you want to word it. One really neat thing that's coming through, and we do in our lab, are specific genome modifications through CRISPR technology. And so this is allowing iPS cardiomyocytes to make really specific tissue diseases, and you don't need the original patients to do it. So I think it's a really powerful thing you can do with these now. And again, the one advantage over embryonic stem cells is you're going to get patient-specific models, and there's a far lower ethic considerations with iPSs than with embryonic stem cells. So in that way, the iPS cardiomyocytes are very powerful. So a lot of my work is done as a collaboration with a cardiac surgeon here, John Coles. So I put up some of the people from my lab who have worked on this, as well as from John Coles' lab and our funding sources. And I'm willing to take any questions. Thanks, everybody, for listening.
And thank you, Jason, for that tour de force of a presentation. And kudos as well to Anne and Siobhan for your equally valuable insights and practical applications of using human cardiomyocytes and phenotypic screens and target validation. Your talks have certainly resonated with our audience, as evidenced by the questions that we have received. Thank you to the audience for attending, but please do not go away as we are about to begin our Q&A session where we're going to try to answer as many of your excellent questions as we can. So why don't we take the first question?
Anne, first question for you. You mentioned these techniques may lead to patient stratification. Will you be testing cardiomyocytes derived from patients with mild and severe pathologies?
So the patient cohorts were assembled based on family-based assessments. And so the iPS lines were actually made from family members that exhibit a range of phenotypes from apparently unaffected to mild to severe.
Thank you very much. And Siobhan, have a question for you. This is one of the only stem cell-based screens in 1536 wells that I know of. Will the methods and or results be published, and will this be offered as a screening service?
So we are working on a publication, trying to get that out. And as far as service-wise, we do – that's one of the things we do in the Conrad Prebys Center at Sanford Burnham is that it's not necessarily a screening service, but we collaborate with investigators and even for-profit or nonprofit in developing data packages, grant applications, or just partnering in general. So those are all things that we do offer at the screening center.
Great, thank you. And Jason, does extracellular calcium concentration and beating frequency play a role in hypertrophy induction in vitro? And how are these parameters controlled?
Yeah, extracellular calcium is interesting because the extracellular calcium can affect the intracellular calcium concentration, which is really indicative of heart failure. So you can modulate the intracellular calcium and model certain cardiac diseases in that exact fashion. So you have to be careful in comparing different results that you're using very similar calcium concentrations in the media, but also between experiments, but also that that calcium concentration is indicative of what the cell will normally see, so that you're not inducing changes in the intracellular calcium environment as a result of either high or low calcium in the media. So they have to be consistent more than anything, but also kept within a relatively physiologic range.
Okay, thank you. And is the screening center moving away from target-based screens toward phenotypic screens? If so, what are some of the hurdles associated with this shift? That is, medicinal chemistry efforts based on the phenotype versus a target?
So I have to say we're not really moving away from target-based screens at all. We use the approach that best fits the project, whether it be a target-based or a phenotypic screen. That being said, we have built up quite a lot of capabilities in-house for high-content phenotypic screening, even in ultra-high throughput 1536-based plates. So you are correct. Medicinal chemistry efforts are considerably complicated by a phenotypic screen, where the target is unknown. It's difficult to drive SAR. Oftentimes the dynamic range of the assay isn't sufficient as well. So it's really just a balance, a matter of whether or not the phenotype being screened is compelling enough to counter the attendant problems with medicinal chemistry that go along with not knowing your target.
Okay, thank you. And Siobhan, were the cardiomyocytes plated directly into the 384 well plates, or did they go through a pre-plating process in a larger vessel and then transferred to the assay plates?
Right. So we maintained the stem cells as normal in flasks for the 7 to 10 days and then transferred them into the plates and suspension. So we tested that both as adherent, so that they're plated in 384 well, and then tested 10 days later in 384 well, and then also did the suspension in order to prove that the suspension assay worked just as the 384 well adherent worked.
Great. And Jason, can cardiomyocytes be used for screening positive and negative effects of peptide analogs or natural peptides?
We've shown that a lot of the extracellular receptors that are present, and others have shown that a lot of the extracellular receptors that are present in normal cardiomyocytes are also present in the iPS cardiomyocytes. And the trick here is really the digestion of the peptides. And so part of what we do is we look at ways to make non-digestible peptides as therapeutics, like cyclic peptides or things like that. And so depending on the design of the cyclic peptide, you're less likely to have it digested in the media, which also contains proteases because they have serum, obviously. And so it's actually a fairly good correlation between if they're digested in the media and if they have a decent serum stability for patient application. So it's actually a decent model for that. But we have used both linear and cyclic peptides with a much greater success of the cyclic peptides both getting intracellularly but also not being digested by the serum, the proteases in the serum.
Okay, let's go back to Anne. Someone says, very interesting work. Why are you using BNP instead of ANP as a hypertrophic marker?
So we selected BNP because it's a typical marker that's used in the clinic for hypertrophy. But as well, we had compared BNP, ANP early on, and we felt BNP was the more robust marker in the assay.
Okay, to the point. Great. And Siobhan, the initial phenotypic screen hit on several compounds that resulted in mitochondrial protection. Are you pulling compounds out of the larger screen that have this same endpoint? And are other types of endpoint modulation, such as ER stress, being identified by the larger screen?
Well, the short answer is we don't know the endpoints yet because it's the phenotypic screen. We hope that we're identifying. There's about 7 scaffolds that we've identified so far that we're moving forward with. And the hope is that those may have different endpoints, and that's the advantage of a phenotypic screen, is that it is open to different pharmacology. Anne mentioned some of the challenges in trying to follow up with that with chemistry because of phenotypic, and that's why we did do the proof of concept study with the known libraries to show that we could, in a suspension assay, pull out compounds that are in fact have mitochondrial protection activities that are shown in the literature. So the hope is we'll find different novel compounds with novel mechanisms.
Great. And Jason, you get such good correlation between the results of an iPSC-CM and the mice model. However, you mentioned in the start of your talk that the mice is not a good model for HF. Can you comment about this apparent discrepancy?
Yeah, I think that the goal here is to model whatever disease you're looking at in the best way possible. And so the mouse, its heart is completely reliant on chronotropy or rate to include its or increase its cardiac output. And where that's true in a neonatal human, but as humans from about really 8 to 12 months and then more so as they go up, they start relying on squeeze or inotropy as well in addition to increasing the rate. So you have at the baseline different cardiac physiology that makes it challenging to model disease accurately in the two. And for that reason, we model both mouse but also pig, which has a heart much more similar to a human's. Neither of those obviously have the human proteome, and you can have slightly different differences as a result. It so happened in ours that we did get a good phenotype from our protein overexpression or transgenics in the mouse, in addition to application of our therapeutic compounds to them. I wouldn't say that's generally the way to go per se, but it's a way to test things. The advantage of the mouse, obviously, that it's quite cheap, and you can do transgenics where pig transgenics are incredibly expensive. So, I mean, you take the model with what you can to give you some evidence. We do have a slightly different stress in the mouse as well that's not quite identical to what we'd see in the humans, but I wouldn't expect that this would be applicable all the time, but in our particular instance, it did. I think it's good to start with a human proteome and a human model and work your way up from there.
And Anne, can you conduct a screen on cardiac fibroblasts rather than cardiac myocytes?
So that's an interesting question. And yeah, we certainly could easily conduct a screen on cardiac fibroblasts. And we suspect that the fibroblasts themselves and the matrix they produce may be an important component of the disease model. So that's something that we're looking into modeling actually right now, producing cardiac fibroblasts from the patient iPSC.
Well, great. Hey, unfortunately, we have run out of time on the webinar, but please note that the webinar will be archived for 6 months on our website, www.genengnews.com. If you missed parts of it, you can watch it again, or you can recommend it to your colleagues and friends, which we, in turn, highly recommend. Thanks again to the panel for the outstanding presentations, and I want to say thank you to our audience for your attention and for your very thoughtful questions about various topics brought up during the webinar. And thank you to Cellular Dynamics International, whose support made this webinar possible. Bye-bye for now.